Solitude and endless storms. That it would be better to live like that than to die so very soon. If only he could live. Lord, what truth there is in that. Lord, what truth. If only he could live, live, and live. Lord, what truth. Lord, what truth.
Ah! You're awake! Well, here I am. In a second or two, I'll show you how I spent the money.
What time is it?
You have slept in grand style, brother. What? It is evening outside. It must be 6 o'clock. You've been asleep for about 6 hours.
Good Lord, what's wrong with me?
Oh, come on. What's wrong with you? What's wrong with you? It will have done you good. Where's the hurry? Look, I've already been here for about 3 hours. How are you feeling, brother?
I'm all right. I'm not ill.
Good, good, good.
Razuminkin, have you been here long?
I told you, I've been here for about 3 hours.
No, but before that.
Well, what do you mean before
that? How long has it been since you began visiting this house?
But I mean, I told you all of that this morning. Or have you forgotten? Look. Do you see this little casket? Huh? Would you like to try it on?
No, later. Afterwards.
Don't be so quarrelsome, brother. I bought it on a guest. Now look. Perfect. You see? It fits perfectly. What a man wears on his head, brother, is the most important item of his costume. It's a sort of an introduction, in a way, huh? Now I must warn you, I am rather proud of the breeches.
Stop it! I don't want all of this, okay?
No good making a fuss, brother.
Out of whose money did you buy all this?
Whose money? Your own! Your mother sent it to you! Or have you forgotten?
My mother. I remember now.
Almost. It is now more than 2 months since I last spoke to you by letter, and I've suffered on that account. Some nights I haven't even been able to sleep for thinking about it. You know how I love you.
How we love you.
You are the only one we think of, Dunya and I.
You're everything to us, all our hopes and aspirations rolled into one.
How terrible I felt when I learned a few months ago that you had dropped out of the university because you couldn't manage to support yourself. The 15 rubles I sent you 4 months ago, I borrowed, as you yourself know, on the strength of my pension. But now, thank God, I think I shall be able to send you a bit more. And indeed, in general, we can now actually boast of our good fortune, which is what I'm in such a hurry to tell you about. I must tell you, dear Rodya, that a bachelor has been seeking Dunya's hand in marriage, and she has now given her consent, a fact of which I hasten to notify you at the earliest possible moment. He's already a lieutenant colonel in the civil service. His name is
Pyotr Petrovich Luzhin.
He's a man of business. He's hard at work.
And he's already in a hurry to get to St. Petersburg, so every moment is precious to him.
Of course, at first we were both very surprised, as the whole thing has happened so suddenly and unexpectedly.
We both spent the whole of that day weighing the pros and cons and thinking about the matter.
He is a very trustworthy and well-to-do man, has two positions, and already has capital of his own. It is true that he's almost 45, but he has a very pleasant appearance and may still be attractive to women. And indeed, in general, he is a very decent and respectable man. Just a little arrogant and on the gloomy side. But that might just be how he appears at first sight. Now, I warn you, precious Rodya, when you meet him in St. Petersburg, which will be very soon now, you mustn't judge him too quickly or hastily, the way you usually do when you don't like something about someone at first sight. Well, you know what your sister is like, Rodya. She is a steadfast, sensible, patient, and magnanimous girl. Though she does have a fiery heart, something I've come to know quite well. Of course, neither on his side nor hers is there any great love. But Dunya, apart from being a clever girl, is, at the same time, being as noble as an angel. And she will make it her duty to constitute the happiness of her husband, who in his turn will care about hers. Of the last, we have, as of yet, no major reason to doubt. Though I do admit, the whole thing has happened a bit quickly. I mentioned Pyotr Petrovich is on his way to St. Petersburg.
So, dear Rodya, he may be extremely useful to you in all sorts of ways.
And in fact, Dunya and I have already come to the conclusion that it would be perfectly possible, starting this very day, for you to begin to put together a carrier for yourself, and that you might consider your future already clearly planned out. Well, Dunya dreams of nothing else. But in spite of the fact that we may very soon be meeting face to face, I will still send you as much money as I can in the next few days. Now that everybody knows Dunya is to marry Pyotr Petrovich, my credit has suddenly shot up. But now, I embrace you until our imminent meeting and send you my maternal blessing. I pray for you. Do you remember, my darling, when you were still only a child? Back in the day when your father was still alive, I used to prattle your prayers on my knee. How happy we all were then. Goodbye. Or rather, until we meet, I hug you as tight, and I send you kisses without number. Yours to the tomb, Pulcheria.
And Dunya.
Oh, Raskolnikov.
Let me, Mother.
Hey, what is it? What's the matter with you?
What is
it? Leave me alone!
Leave you alone, huh? Come on, you dare tell me to leave you alone?
Listen, Razumikin! Are you really unable to see that I don't want your good deeds? Hmm? And what is this desire of yours to do good deeds for people who spit upon them? Who, if truth be told, find them a serious burden on their endurance? I mean, why? Why did you bother to track me down when I first felt ill? Huh? What if I'd only been too happy to die, huh?
Roger.
After all, surely I've made it plain enough to you today that you've been tormenting me, that I'm fed up with you. Tell me, what can I do to stop you pestering me and doing good deeds for me? Only leave off, for God's sake, leave off. God.
Then clear off with you and go to the devil.
Razumikin, wait, look, this is what I wanted to talk to you about. You know that fellow, what's his name? Porfiry Petrovich?
I should think I do, he's a relative of mine. Why do you ask, Roger?
Well, yesterday, you said that he's in charge of this case, this murder business?
Yes, and?
Well, you said that he was questioning some of the people who'd pawned things with that old woman. Well, I also pawned some stuff with her too. Just rubbish, but there was a ring of my sister's, which she gave to me as a keepsake when I first left for St. Petersburg. And my father's silver pocket watch. All of it only cost 5 to 6 rubles, but they're precious to me for the memories they contain. So what am I to do? I don't want to lose the object, particularly the watch. It's the only thing of my father's that we have left in the family. I know I ought to go to the police station, but wouldn't it be better if I just went to see Porfiry instead? What do you think?
Yes, on no account go to the police. Please, brother, by all means, go and see Porfiry. Hang it all. Let's go there now. It's only a couple of yards away, and we are sure to find him in. Come. And Roger, listen, you never told me that you had also pawned things with the old woman. Why? I mean, how long ago was this, even, that you went to see her?
Well, I think I went to see her just 3 days before she died.
Wait, what? Look, what's that? What on earth?
Look, don't you see that?
Roger!
Look, there's
Roger! The what's wrong?
What's happened?
It's nothing. He's fainted, that's all. See, he's coming around again
no.
already. See?
No! No, go home with him, okay? Until tomorrow, please. Let's leave this all until tomorrow. No.
Rodia, I absolutely refuse to
no,
leave.
No, stop harassing me.
I can stay with him.
No, time. Go home. I can't cope with it, okay? That's enough.
What's the matter? Okay, can't I look at him? It's been 3 years since I've seen him.
Mother, come on. We're having a bad effect on him. Let's at least get out of the room for a minute.
Wait. Have you met up with Luzhin yet?
Not yet, Rodya, but he already knows we've arrived.
Dunya, I don't want you to go ahead with that marriage. And so first thing tomorrow, you must tell him that you've refused his offer and that he must never come near us ever again.
Oh my God.
Think what you're saying, brother. Rodya, I suppose you're in no state to think about it right now. You're too tired.
Because I'm too delirious? No. Dunya, you're marrying Luzhin for my sake, and I won't accept your sacrifice. That's why you must go to him and tell him that you refuse his offer, and that will be the end of the matter.
I can't do that, Rodya!
Dunya!
Dunetka! You're getting too worked up, both of you. Stop it! Now look, tomorrow... Come on, we better go away.
Until tomorrow, brother. Come on, mother. Goodbye, Rodya.
Listen, sister. This marriage you're planning is vile business. I may be a villain, but you mustn't. Some jumped up nobody. I refuse to accept any sister who does such things as a sister of mine. It's either me or Luzhin.
Okay,
now go!
Hey, Roger!
Stop!
You are out of your mind. I'm sorry. Please, allow me to see you home. God only knows you can't go out into the streets of St. Petersburg alone. When I've seen you safely there, I will return here at the double, and a quarter of an hour later, so cross my heart, I'll bring you a report of how he's doing, and all the rest of it. If he's okay, then you can go to bed, and if he's not, I swear to you, I will bring you here myself, huh? I can stay the night in the passage as well. He won't even know I'm there. I'll get Zosimov the doctor to spend the night as well. Well, so there you go. How about it? Off you go home. Come on, don't you trust me? Well, do you?
Come on, Mother. I expect he'll do as he says. He's already revived the project, and it's true that the doctor would agree to spend the night. What could be better?
Ah, there! You see? You see? You, miss. You understand me, huh? Because you are an angel.
Oh, my goodness. I really don't know.
If only you knew. How much I love you both. Now, please, don't laugh, and don't be angry. You can be angry with anyone else, but not with me. Look, I am Roger's friend, so that means I am your friend too, right? Listen, last year, I had a premonition. There was a moment exactly like this, but... Well, I don't suppose it was a premonition at all, because you two have quite simply come from nowhere, fallen from heaven. Now I don't imagine I'll be able to sleep all night, but please, trust me. Come on, do you trust me?
My goodness, I really don't know.
Yes. Yes, we do.
Yes? You say yes?
Yes.
Well, if you can say that, then you are the fount of goodness and purity and reason and perfection. Come, please, give me your hand. Please, give me yours too. Come, please. I should very much like to kiss them. Here and now, on my knees.
Oh, huh? Stop. I beg of you, what are you doing?
Open up. Stand up.
Oh, dear Lord. Oh, Dunechka, what's going to happen?
Oh, calm down, Mother. This gentleman has been sent by God himself. We may rely on him. I do assure you we may.
Well, please. So off you go home. Please. Right this way.
My papa was a civil service colonel and very nearly a governor. He only had one more step to climb up the ladder, and everyone would come from miles around to see him, and they'd say, "We all consider you our governor, Ivan Mikhailovich." When Princess Bessimelna saw me at the Marshal's last ball, she gave me her blessing when I married my husband. She asked me at once, "Are you not the charming young lady who danced with the shawl at the graduation ball?" And then there was Prince Shigalskoy, a gentleman of the royal bedchamber who had just arrived from St. Petersburg. He danced the mazurka with me and declared his intention to come to me the following day with a proposal of marriage. But I thanked him in a flattering language and told him that my heart belonged to another and had done so for a long time. That other is my current husband, Semyon Zakharovich Marmeladov. was horribly angry at me. And now my drunken husband has ruined me and will ruin us all. Where is that drunken vagabond? He's worn his shirt in like some floor cloth that's full of holes. I wanted to wash the whole lot together so as not to have this torture 2 nights running. Good God! You must be wondering, where is my husband? Where is my husband? Well, he got what he wanted. He got what he deserved. You can see what has happened to Semyon Zakharovich Marmeladov. He's dying. I must ask you now to bolt that door and not let anyone in. At least let him die in peace. If you do not, I wish to make it clear that your behavior will be reported to the Governor General himself. The prince knew me before I was married and has a very clear memory of Semyon Zakharovich, to whom on many occasions he was a benefactor. Everyone knows Semyon Zakharovich had many friends and patrons whom he himself relinquished out of decent pride, aware of his unhappy weakness. And now we're being helped by a certain magnanimous young man who has possessed our means and connections and whom Semyon Zakharovich knew as a young boy. You might at least let him die in peace. What? Come to watch the performance, huh? With cigarettes in your mouth? Oh, that's right. Come on in with your hats on, I don't mind. There's one wearing his hat right now. Well, get out of here! Show some respect for a dead man! What am I supposed to do now? What am I supposed to do now? He was drunk. He walked under those horses himself. He never brought in any income, just a lot of trouble. He's a drunkard, you know. He drank everything we owned. He stole our things and took them to that drinking house, used up their lives and my own in that place he did. I'm glad he's dead. We'll be a bit better off. We'll be a bit better off. What am I supposed to do now? What am I supposed to do now? Someone tell me, please.
Katerina Ivanovna. What? Rodion Raskolnikov gave us 20 rubles for the funeral.
Is a marvelous gentleman, brother, you'll see. A very, very clever chap, and with a lot of common sense even, huh? I will grant you, he has a rather peculiar cast of mind, but just last year, there was a case that he cleared up involving murder, in which nearly all of the cases, all of the evidence had been lost. He's very, very, very anxious to meet you.
Why all the berries?
Oh, no, it's just recently, you see, when you had fallen ill. He and I would get to talking, and I often and repeatedly found myself mentioning you, that's all. And he thought it would be prudent, wonderful even, to be able
you
to-
You know what, brother? I have noticed that ever since this morning, you've been in a state of extraordinary excitement. True?
I don't know what you're talking about, Roger.
Well, it was just earlier this morning, I saw that you were looking at my sister in a very specific way.
I did no such thing, sir.
No.
Hmm?
My God, you're cringing like a schoolboy. For heaven's sake, what are you so embarrassed about?
You swine.
Romeo.
Take it back.
Romeo, I'm going to tell a few people about this today. I'll make my mother laugh.
You will not.
Someone else's
mouth. Oh, you will not.
Romeo.
You swine.
Romeo.
You.
Romeo.
Get back here. I'll put you to the cave. Ow, you horrible. I say.
Why break the chairs, gentlemen? Please, please, please forgive me. Raskolnikov's the name.
Oh, for goodness sake. Well, it's a pleasure to meet you, sir. Very pleasantly you came in, too. What about him? Doesn't he want to say hello?
I honestly don't know why he got into such a rage at me. All I did was to call him a Romeo and backed it up with evidence.
You swine!
Well, there must be something very serious behind it if he lost his temper at one little word.
Oh, and you! You investigator! Oh, enough of that. Enough, enough. Please, we're all behaving like fools. Roger, come. This is my friend, Rodion Romanovich Raskolnikov, eh? In the first, he's heard a lot about you, and he would love to meet you. And in the second, he has a small item of business he needs to attend to.
Well, you see, I heard that you were questioning some of the people who'd pawned things with that murdered old woman, Alyona Ivanovna. Well, you see, I also pawned some stuff with her, too. Just rubbish, but there was a ring of my sister's, which she gave to me as a keepsake, and my father's silver pocket watch. All of it only costs 5 to 6 rubles, but they're still precious to me for the memories they contain. So what am I to do?
What you should do is make a statement to the police. What you say is having learned of such and such an occurrence. This murder, in other words. Mm-hmm. You, in your turn, wish to inform the investigator in charge of the case that such and such objects are items of your possession, and that you wish to redeem them. Something of that sort. As a matter of fact, they'll write it for you.
Well, what I'd like to do, you see, is just simply make a declaration that these objects are mine, and that when I have the money, then...
That doesn't make any difference, sir. But, if you like, you can simply write directly to me, saying something of the same effect.
Can I write it on ordinary paper?
Oh, on the most ordinary you wish, sir.
Hi, there, you see? Look, and you fairly flew up in the air yesterday when I happened to mention that Uncle Porfiry had been the one questioning people who had pawned things with the old woman.
My father's silver pocket watch is the only thing of his that we have left in the family. Don't laugh, and I don't want to lose it.
I've been waiting for you to get here for ages.
What? Wait, Uncle, you mean you knew he had pawned things with the old woman?
Both of your articles, the ring and the watch, were found in her apartment wrapped in the same piece of paper with your name clearly marked in pencil on it, together with the day she received them from you.
Well, how come you're so observant? I mean, there must have been an awful lot of people who'd pawned things with her, right? So many that it must have been hard for you to remember who they all were.
Practically all those who'd pawned things are now known to us. You're the only one who hasn't been so good as to oblige.
Well, I have not been entirely well, sir.
I have heard that too, sir. I had the pleasure of reading an article 2 months ago. Can't remember the title now, but it was of a constant interest to me, actually. You wrote On Crime, or something it was called. It was in the periodical Leader.
An article by me? In the periodical Leader? It's true I did write one 6 months after I left the university. It was a review of a book. But that was for the newspaper The Weekly Leader, not the periodical.
Well, the periodical's where it ended
No,
up.
But I mean The Weekly Leader went out of circulation, and that's why it was never printed.
That's true, sir. But when it went out of circulation, The Weekly Leader was incorporated into the periodical Leader. And so, 2 months ago, your article appeared in the periodical Leader. Didn't you know?
Well, how did you know that article was by me, though?
There was nothing but a pair of initials at the bottom of it.
Oh, I found out by chance. Just the other day, actually. Through the editor. He's an acquaintance of mine. I was very interested.
Well, let's see. My article was on the psychological state of a criminal's mind throughout the entire process of committing his crime, wasn't
it?
Yes,
sir. And you insisted that the enactment of a crime is invariably accompanied by illness. Most original. But that wasn't actually the part of your little article that interested me so much. In short, if you remember, you made an allusion to the idea that there may exist in the world certain persons who are able, or rather, who are not only able, but have a perfect right to commit all sorts of atrocities and crimes, and that it's as if the law did not apply to them.
What on earth? Roger, what on earth? A right to crime, is
that? No. It had nothing to do with that. The whole point of his article is that the human race is divided into the ordinary and the extraordinary. The ordinary do not have the right to break the law because they're ordinary, you see. The extraordinary, on the other hand, have the right to break the law in all sorts of ways and commit all sorts of crimes precisely because they're extraordinary. That's more or less what you wrote, isn't it? If
what?
I'm not mistaken.
What the devil? No, I'm sorry. There must be some mistake. This can't be right.
If you say that my article is obscure, I'm prepared to explain it to you to the best of my ability. I think I'm not mistaken in supposing that that is what you would like me to do. By all means. It is my view that if the discoveries of Kepler and Newton could not, on any account, as a result of certain complex factors, have become known to mankind other than by means of sacrificing the life of one person, the lives of 10, 100, or even more persons who were trying to interfere with those discoveries or stand as an obstacle on their path, then Newton would have had a right and would have even been obliged to get rid of those 10 or 100 persons in order that those discoveries might become known to all mankind. From this, it of course does not follow that Newton had the right to kill anyone and everyone he wanted to or go stealing from the market every day. In short, I argued that all people, not only the great, but even those who deviate only marginally from the common rut, that's to say, those who are only marginally capable of saying something new, are bound, by their very nature, to be criminals. To a greater or lesser extent, of course. As you will perceive, there's nothing particularly new in my argument so far. All this has been printed and read 1,000 times before! As for my division of people into the ordinary and extraordinary, I will admit that it is somewhat arbitrary, but after all, I don't insist on precise figures. It's only my central idea that I place my faith in. No, all I did was quite simply to allude to the fact that an extraordinary person has a right, not an official one, but a private one, to allow his conscience to step across certain obstacles and then, only then, if the execution of his idea, which may occasionally be the salvation of all mankind, requires it.
Well, thank you, sir. But now, tell me this. How do you distinguish these extraordinary folk from the ordinary ones? I mean, do they have some sort of special birthmark? Well, perhaps they could be given some sort of special clothing to wear. Or maybe... maybe they could be branded.
For I think you'd agree, yeah, if there were to be a mix-up and a person from one of the categories thought he belonged to the other and started clearing away all the obstacles, as you so neatly called them. I mean...
well, that happens all the time. And that remark was even wittier than your last one.
Thank you, sir.
Not at all, sir. But please, bear in mind that mistakes are only possible on the part of the first category of people. That is, of the ordinary, as I perhaps quite unsuitably call them. This unfortunately leads a rather large number of them to fondly suppose that they're progressive individuals, and this under the guise of destroyers appropriating the new word for themselves, and this in all sincerity, sir. But you really need not be anxious, as I don't believe they represent any significant threat, because they never get very far. But of course, it would do them no harm to give them a thrashing now and then, to punish them for getting carried away, and to remind them of their rightful place. But no more than that.
Well, sir, you've set my mind at ease a little on that score, at least. But you know, there are other things that trouble me. Please tell me, are there many of these people who have a right to murder others? Of these extraordinary folk, I mean. I'm prepared to treat them with the respect they merit, of course. But you must admit, it would be a bit terrifying if there were a great many of them, sir. Hmm?
On the whole, there are extremely few people with new ideas, or who are even the merest bit capable of saying something new. So few that it's almost strange.
What are you both doing? Are you playing jokes or something? Right? Are you pulling each other's legs, or aren't you? Are you being serious, Roger? Well, brother, if this really is serious, then of course, he's right. This resembles all things that have been read and heard 1,000 times before. But what is really original about all of this, and this really is your own exclusive property, much to my horror, is that you condone the shedding of blood on grounds of conscience. And if you'll pardon me, with such fanaticism. I mean, to condone the shedding of blood on grounds of conscience is, in my opinion, far worse than if it were to be permitted officially by law.
Perfectly true, it is far worse.
No, you got carried away, that's all. I'll read the article.
Look, none of that was actually in my article, okay? It was merely alluded to.
Quite so, sir, quite so. I think I've almost grasped the way in which you choose to view crime, sir. But please forgive me for being so insistent. But there are certain practical possibilities that still bother me. Oh, take some man, or some young chap, who imagines he's a Lycurgus or a Mahomet, a budding one, of course. Well, off he goes to clear away all the obstacles, and he says to himself, I have a long way ahead of me, and I'll need some money for the road. Well, so, he goes about getting his hands on that money. You know what I mean?
Oh, that happens all the time. The stupid and vain are particularly liable to swallow that hook, especially the young.
Well, sir, you take my point then. I mean, how can that be allowed, sir?
That's just the way things are. It's not my fault they're like that. That's the way things are, and that's how they've always been. But what's there to worry about? I mean, society's all too well provided with such phenomena as exile, prison, legal investigators, penal servitude. So what's there to worry about?
All you have to do is catch your thief.
Well then, say we do catch him. What then?
He got what he deserves.
One can't say you're not logical. Well, sir, and what about his conscience?
Why should you care about that?
Oh, for humanitarian reasons, sir.
Well, if he has one, he'll suffer when he realizes the error of his ways. That's his punishment. That in addition to penal servitude.
But what about the really talented ones? I mean, these few who have been granted the right to murder? Are they not obliged to suffer at all, even for the blood that they've already shed?
Why do you use the word obliged? There's no permission or prohibition involved in all this. Let him suffer if he's sorry for his victim. Pain and suffering are inevitable for persons of broad awareness and depth of heart. The truly great are, in my view, always bound to feel a great deal of sadness during their time upon this earth.
Well, sir, you'll no doubt curse me for this, and it'll probably make you angry. But I simply cannot restrain myself. Please, permit me to give expression to one more little question. One more little idea, simply so I don't forget it.
Very well. Tell me your little idea.
Well, you see, sir, it's like this. That when you were writing your article, you too considered yourself to be one of the extraordinary people who can say a new word, in the sense you've explained. I mean, is that the case, sir?
I wouldn't rule it out.
And if that is the case, then is it really possible that you may also have decided, oh, because of some everyday setback of financial difficulty, let's say, to step across an obstacle? Oh, by robbing and murdering someone, for example. If I had, I certainly wouldn't tell you. But you must understand, my interest stems solely from a desire to understand your article and is of a purely literary nature.
Let me make something very clear to you.
That I consider myself neither a Muhammad nor Napoleon nor any persons of that kind. And not being one of those persons, am consequently unable to give you a satisfactory account of how I might have behaved.
Oh, for heaven's sake. Who doesn't think he's a Napoleon among us in Russia these days?
Yes, and perhaps it was some budding Napoleon who did in old Alyona Ivanovna with an axe last week, eh?
Off already?
Yes.
Most glad to have made your acquaintance, sir. Oh, and the best thing would be if you were to come and see me there in a day or two. Well, why not tomorrow? We can have a bit of a talk. Sort it all out. As one of the last ones to have been there, you may be able to tell us a few things.
So you're going to question me, officially, with all the trappings?
Now why would I want to do that, sir? It's not at all required for the time being. You took what I said the wrong way. I hope to see you soon, sir.
Let's go.
I'm sorry, I don't quite understand all of this.
This may be the last time that I ever speak to you again. I may not see you again.
Are you going somewhere?
No, I don't know. I'll find out everything tomorrow. Why are you standing up? Come, sit down. You're so thin. Look at those hands of yours. One can see right through them. They're like a corpse's.
I've always been like this.
Your father told me everything about you before he died. I know everything about you. About how you go out at 6 and come back at 9. About how Katerina Ivanovna used to kneel before your bed. You know what? Katerina Ivanovna has incurable consumption. She's going to die soon.
No,
but I mean,
no.
It might be better if she dies.
No, it's not.
And what are you going to do with the children? Where will you take them if not here with you?
I don't know.
And what if you were to fall ill even now while Katerina Ivanovna is still alive? What if you were taken to the hospital, to the police station?
Stop it. What
would happen then?
Stop it. That's not possible.
Not possible? You're not insured, are you? You know what would happen? The whole gang of you would be out in the street. Katerina Ivanovna would be coughing, begging, beating her head against a wall as she did today. And the children, well, they'd be crying. And then Katerina Ivanovna would collapse. She'd be taken to the police station,
to the hospital. And there, she would die. And then what would happen?
No.
What would happen to the
children? No, God won't let it happen. God will look after her. He will.
But what if there isn't even any God?
Sonia. You say that Katerina Ivanovna's mind is growing confused. It's your own, that is.
Why are you doing that? Why? In front of me? I'm a great sinner.
It wasn't you I was bowing to, but the whole human suffering. And as for your being a great sinner, Sonia, that's simply a fact. And you're even more of a sinner because you've mortified and betrayed yourself for nothing. Isn't that monstrous? Isn't it monstrous that you're living in this filth, which you hate and loathe, while all the while you know you only have to open your eyes, that you're neither helping nor saving anyone by it? And I mean, tell me, how such turpitude and vileness can exist inside you, along such other holy and opposing emotions? I mean, it would be more just, 1,000 times more just and more reasonable, for you to just throw yourself headfirst into the water, and be done with it. So you say a lot of prayers to God, do you, Sonia?
What would I be without God?
And what does God do you in return?
That's enough! Don't ask such questions. You don't deserve an answer.
Where's the bit about the raising of Lazarus? Find it and read it to me.
Haven't you read it before?
A long time ago when I was in school.
Haven't you heard it in church?
No, I don't go. Do you?
No.
So I suppose that means you won't be going to your father's funeral tomorrow?
No, I will. I went to church last week. For another funeral.
Whose?
Lizaveta's. Someone murdered her with an axe.
You were friendly with Lizaveta?
Oh, yes. She was a righteous woman. She would come. Seldom. It was difficult for her. She and I would read and talk together. She will see God.
Go on, just read it, please.
Now there was a certain sick man named Lazarus of
Bethany.
Let's be off. We're cursed together. So let's take the road together.
Where to?
How should I know? All I know is that it must be the same road towards the same goal. Now come.
But I don't understand.
You're necessary to me, and that is why I have come to you.
I don't understand.
You will later on. You've done the same thing, after all, haven't you? You've wrecked a life. You've committed moral suicide. Your own. It's all the same, isn't it? You might have lived a life of reason in the spirit, but you'll end up in the Haymarket. And you won't be able to endure it. And if you remain alone like me, you'll go mad like me. You're like a mad woman even now. And that is why we must go together now along the same road.
Why? Why are you saying this?
Why? Because you can't go on like this, that's why. You must finally confront things seriously and directly and not weep and wail like a child about God not letting it happen. That's why. What? You don't understand?
Sonia, this may be the last time that I ever see you again. But if I come back tomorrow, I will tell you who killed Lizaveta.
You mean, you know who murdered her?
I know. And I'll tell you, you I'll tell, and you alone. I singled you out. Well, goodbye. Until tomorrow.
Thank you.
Well, good sir. So here you are in our neck of the woods.
I brought you...
My dear fellow.
I brought you that application. About the watch? Look, here it is. Have I written it out correctly, or do I need to copy it out again?
What? Oh, that letter! Ah, yes, yes. Have no fear. That will do perfectly, sir. Yes, that will do perfectly. No more than that is required.
I think you said yesterday that you had some formal questions to ask me about how well I knew the woman who was murdered.
Yes, yes, yes. Please, don't let me put you to any bother. Everything is perfectly all right. We've all the time in the world, sir. All the time in the world.
Porfiry Petrovich! Yesterday, you expressed to me the desire that I should come here and see you in order that you might put certain questions to me. I have come as you requested. So if there is anything you would like to ask me, then please do so. Otherwise, you'll forgive me if I leave. I don't have much time.
Great heavens above! What's all this you're going on about? Rodion Romanovich, what would I be doing questioning you? I'm actually very pleased you've come to see us at last. I view you as my personal guest. And as for that accursed laughter, Rodion Romanovich, you'll have to forgive me. Oh, do sit down. Please, otherwise I shall think you're angry with me. Oh, I say, do take off that cap of yours. Anyone would think you're just about to leave. Really makes me feel uncomfortable just to look at you. As I said, I'm really very pleased you're here. You're studying law, aren't you, Rodion Romanovich?
Yes, or rather I was.
Well then, here's a little example for you, in the form of a case study, as it were. One that you might like to keep in mind for the future. Suppose I considered this, that, or the other person to be guilty of committing a crime. Well, why, I ask, should I inconvenience that fellow before I need to? Even though I've got evidence against him, sir. Suppose I leave a certain gentleman completely alone. I don't arrest him and I don't trouble him, but I make damn sure that every hour and every minute he knows, or at least suspects, that I know everything. The whole seamy story, and that I'm keeping an eye on him night and day, watching him unremittingly. And if he's conscious of the never-ending suspicion and terror in which I'm keeping him, I'll tell you, sir, he'll go off into a whirl. He'll come running of his own accord. That's always most gratifying, sir. If only I give him enough latitude, on he'll go performing a circular orbit around. Narrowing the radius further and further until... pop! He'll fly straight into my mouth and I'll swallow him whole. Most gratifying. Do you believe me, sir? He'll come to the station himself and ask, "Why are they taking so long to arrest me?" Human nature is a mirror, sir. A mirror of the most transparent kind. Look in it and feast your eyes, sir.
Porfiry Petrovich! It is clear to me now that you definitely suspect me of having murdered that old woman and her sister Lizaveta. If you believe that you have the right to prosecute me, then please, do so. If you're going to arrest me, arrest me. But I won't allow you to laugh in my face and torment me like this. Do you hear, Porfiry Petrovich? I won't allow it!
Great heavens above! What's all this now? Rodion Romanovich, what's the matter?
I won't allow it! I will not allow it!
Rodion Romanovich, you know you'll drive yourself crazy if you go on like this. Yes, sir. Now, I wish you well. And I tell you once and for all, look after your illness particularly since your family's here now. What you should be doing is putting them at ease and spoiling them a bit.
What business?
But all you do is frighten them.
What business is that of yours? How do you know that? Why are you so interested? Does this mean that you've been following me around and trying to demonstrate it to me?
My dear fellow, why, it's from you. From you yourself that I've learned all this. You don't seem to notice that in your agitation you tell me and others everything.
You're lying. I don't know what your motives are, but you're lying. It's impossible for me to be mistaken. You're lying. You're lying. Look, what I want to know, once and for all, is do you consider me free from suspicion, or do you not? Come on, Porfiry Petrovich, and give me a clear and final answer. Tell me now, I want to hear it.
My goodness. What a job. What a job I'm having with you. Why, you're just like a child who wants to play with magic.
I will say it again. I can no longer endure
it. What, sir? The uncertainty?
Stop tormenting me! Come on! Arrest me, search my lodgings, do as you please, but do it according to the rule book. Stop!
Oh, don't worry about the rule book. My dear fellow, I invited you here today, as it were, to my home. In a completely friendly fashion.
I don't want your friendship, and I spit upon it. And look, I'm going to take my cap now and leave. Well, what have you got to say to that if you're going to arrest me? I understand everything, everything. You're lying and teasing me to make me give myself away.
You can't give yourself away any further, Rodion Romanovich. My dear fellow.
Thank you.
Sonia?
It's you. Oh, don't speak to me the way you did last night.
On my way out yesterday, I said that I might not ever be seeing you again. But that if I came back today, I would tell you who killed Lisaveta.
How is it that you know?
I just know.
Well, have they found him?
No, they haven't.
Then how do you know about that?
Guess. So you can't guess then?
No.
Then have a proper look.
Oh, merciful Lord. What have you gone and done to yourself? Well, there is no one in this whole world more unhappy than you are now.
So you're not going to leave me?
No. No, I'll never leave you. No matter where you go, I'll follow you. I'll follow you everywhere. But why didn't I meet you earlier? Why didn't you come to me before?
Well, here I am.
Only now? What can we do now? Together. Together we will go, and we will do penal servitude together.
No. No, I will not go and do penal servitude yet.
But how could you? A man like you. Do a thing like this. You were hungry. You did it to help your mother. Was that it?
No. I wasn't that hungry. And I really did want to help my mother. But that's even not quite correct.
But is this all really, really true? And how could you give away the last kopeck you had and yet murder someone in order to rob her? Oh, that money that you gave Katerina Ivanovna. Was that the money?
No. It wasn't that money. Put your mind at rest. That money was given to me by my mother. It was my own, really. It was mine. But as for the other stolen things, I don't even know if there was any money there. I took the purse, but I didn't look inside. I didn't have time. And as for the other pawned objects, I buried all of those the following morning under a rock.
But then why? Why did you say you did it in order to rob her? If you didn't take anything.
I don't know. I don't even know if I'm going to do anything with the money, if there is any there. I need to speak, but I don't know where to begin. I shouldn't have come here. Nope.
No, it's good that you came. It's better that I should know. Far better.
You see, I did it in order to test a theory of mine. Yes. And this is how it happened. You see, my family thinks that I dropped out of university because I was unable to support myself. But you see, that isn't really the case. I very well might have been able to support myself or stay at university had I worked hard enough. I could have gotten a job. I could have been a private teacher. But I turned spiteful and refused. Yes, spiteful. And like a spider, I crept away and hid in my corner. I mean, you've been in my rat hole, Sonia, you've seen it. How I hated that rat hole. Yet even though I hated it, I didn't want to leave it. I made a special point of not wanting to leave it. I would stay there for days on end, unwilling to sleep, unwilling to eat, just lying there. I kept asking myself the question, why are you so stupid? And why is it that others are stupid? And I know for a certain fact that they're stupid. Yet I don't want to do anything about it to make myself cleverer. And then it was that I realized that if I were to wait until everyone else had grown clever, I'd have to wait a very long time. And then I realized that that was never going to happen. That people aren't going to change. And that no one can make them any different from what they are, and that it's not worth the effort to try. That's the law they operate by, Sonia. It's true. And then it was that I understood that those who are strong and powerful in mind are their lord and master. Whoever is able to spit upon the most things, they consider their lawgiver. And the person who takes the most liberties of all is the person who is the most in the right. That's the way it's been in the past, and that's how it always will be. And then I knew, Sonia, that power is only given to those who dare to lower themselves and pick it up.
That's enough.
And listen.
Don't say anymore.
What I had to know, and know quickly, was whether I was a man or a louse, like everyone else. Whether I could dare to take a step across or not. Whether I could dare to lower myself and pick up what was lying there or not. Whether I was a quivering knave, or whether I had a right.
To kill? Whether you
For
had
God's
a right to
sake,
kill?
For God's sake, Sonia! What I was simply trying to prove to you is that the devil led me to do what I did, and only afterwards explained that I had no right to do it. He mocked me. So I came here to you. Receive your guest. Would I have come to you if I weren't a louse? And you should know that when I went to see the old woman that day, I only intended to conduct a rehearsal. Might as well be aware of that.
And you killed her!
But what sort of killing was it? Is that the way that people kill? Do they go about it as I did that day? No. It wasn't the old woman I killed, but myself. I offed myself off in one go forever. Not the old woman. So tell me, what am I to do now?
What are you to do? Get up! Go immediately, this very moment. Go and stand at the crossroads. Bow down. First kiss the ground which you have desecrated, and then bow to the whole world, to all four points of the compass, and tell everyone out loud, I have killed. Then God will send you life again. Will you go?
Is it penal servitude, you mean? Must I go to them?
You must accept suffering and redeem yourself by it.
No, I won't go to them.
But how will you live? How will life be
possible? Why should I go to them? What would I tell them? In fact, I came here to tell you that they're on my trail now. They're going to ensnare me, and they're going to catch me. So, will you visit me in jail when I'm there?
Yes. Yes. Are you wearing a crucifix? No. No, you're not, are you? Well, here. Take this one. It's made of cypress wood. I have another, made of copper. It belonged to Lizaveta. I shall wear it from now on, and this one's for you. We shall go and suffer together. We shall bear our crosses together.
Yes. Yes. But not now. Not now, later.
Yes. Yes, later. When you go to your suffering, that's when you must put it on. You will come to me. I will put it round your neck, and we will pray and take the road together.
Unexpected visitor for you, Rodion Romanovich. You know, I came to see you a couple evenings ago. Perhaps you weren't aware of it. I have come to explain myself to you, dear Rodion Romanovich. To explain myself to you, sir. After some thought, I have reached the conclusion that it is better for us to be candid with each other. No, sir. Suspicions and scenes of that kind cannot continue for long.
Why are you talking like this now?
Why am I talking like this? Well, I've come to explain myself to you, dear Rodion Romanovich, considering it, as it were, my sacred duty to do so. I've made you put up with an awful lot, Rodion Romanovich. I'm not a monster, sir. Why did you come to see me that morning?
Oh, the way you laughed.
The way you laughed when you came in that time, do you remember? I mean, of course, I saw through it all as though through a pane of glass. And if I hadn't been waiting for you in such a peculiar fashion, I'd never even have noticed anything in your laughter. It's what it means to be in the right mood.
Razumikin told me just now that you're still pressing charges against Nikolai, and that you assured him of that fact.
No, Rodion Romanovich. Nikolai's not our man. This is a murky and fantastic case. A contemporary one. An incident that belongs to our own age. It is a case that involves dreams, derived from books, sir. A heart that's been overstimulated by theories. In it, we see a determination to take the first step, but it's a determination of a peculiar kind. The man's taken his resolve, but it's as though he had fallen off a cliff or jumped from a steeple. As though he'd blundered into the crime like some clockwork automaton. He forgot to close the door behind him, and he killed. Killed two people because of a theory. He killed and didn't even bother to take the money that was there. And the things he did take, he hid under a stone. He's committed a murder, yet considers himself an honorable fellow. He has contempt for other people, goes around like some pallid angel. No. Nikolai's not our man, Rodion Romanovich. Nikolai's not our man.
Then who? Who is the murderer?
Who is the murderer? Why, you are the murderer, Rodion Romanovich. You are, sir. I don't think you've quite understood me, and that's why you're so dumbfounded. I've come with the specific purpose of saying everything and bringing the matter out into the open.
It wasn't me. I didn't do it.
Yes, Rodion Romanovich, sir. It was you, and no one else, sir.
Up to your old capers again, Porfiry Petrovich. Still pursuing those methods of yours, I really wonder you're not sick of them by now.
What methods do I need now? In my own mind, I'm convinced, and I don't need you to help me.
If that's so, and if you really think I'm guilty, then why don't you put me in prison?
Well now, there's a question. I've come to you with an open and straightforward proposition. That you should file a plea of guilty. That would be countless times better for you, and better for me too. Because that way, it's over and done with. Am I making sense to you? And another thing, how can you ask why you should file a plea of guilty? Have you any idea what a reduction in your sentence that would mean?
No, I don't want it. It isn't worth it. I really don't want your reduction.
That's what I was afraid of. That's what I was afraid of, that you wouldn't want our reduction. I say, don't turn your nose up at life. You've still a great deal ahead of you. What do you mean you don't want a reduction? What do you mean you imp-
patient man.
A lot of what ahead of me?
Life! What are you, a prophet? What do you mean? Seek and you shall find. Perhaps God's been waiting for you in all this, and you won't have to wear them forever. The fetters.
And who are you? What sort of prophet are you? From what magnificent tranquility are you uttering these wise prophecies to me?
Who am I? Oh, I'm just a man who's had his day. A man who may have feelings and be capable of sympathy, and who may even know a few things. But one who has most definitely had his day.
And you know, Rodion Romanovich, I don't think you should believe everything I say. This is just the way I'm used to carrying on. I'll admit that. And as regards to the question to what extent I'm a villain and what extent I'm a decent man, you may judge for yourself.
So, when are you going to arrest me?
Oh, I might let you wander around for another day and a half. Possibly two. But I say your prayers. It'll be better for you that way. I swear to God it will, I promise.
And what if I run away?
No. You won't run away. You don't believe in your theory now. So what would you run away with? Besides, what good would running away do you?
Being on the run is an unpleasant and arduous business, and what you need most now is to live. You'd run away and come back of your own accord. You can't get on without us. You won't run away.
Let me make something very clear to you. I haven't made any kind of confession to you at all today. You're a strange man. And I've only listened to you out of sheer curiosity. No. I haven't made any kind of confession to you at all. Bear that in mind.
Well, goodbye, sir. I wish you good thoughts and happy undertakings.
I don't know. I kept going down to the Neva River time and time again. I wanted to end it all there.
That was the very thing we were afraid of, Safia Semyonovna and I. Rodion, that means you still believe in life. God be praised. God be praised.
I've never been a believer yet just now. Mother and I had our arms around each other, and I asked her to pray for me.
God knows how that can happen.
You went to see Mother? You told her? Surely you could not have done that!
No, I didn't tell her, not in words. But she sensed a lot of it. Dunya, please forgive me. Though I am guilty, it's out of the question for me to be forgiven. Farewell. It's time, and more than time. I beg you, just go now and sit with Mother. Okay? It is the last and greatest request that I shall make of you. Go now and sit with her. Razumikin will be with you, I told him. He's a good person.
I know.
Goodbye. Until later. I mean, we're not parting forever. Sonia, I have come for your crosses. I decided that it may be better for me to do it this way. Well, where are they, your crosses? This is meant to symbolize my taking up the cross?
Please, Make the sign of the cross over yourself. Please say at least one prayer.
Very well.
No, Sonia, I will go alone.
Go up to the crossroads, bow to the people, kiss the earth because you have sinned against it too, and tell the whole world out loud.
I must admit, I'm the person. I'm the person. I murdered that old civil servant's widow and her sister, Lizaveta, that day. I robbed them. And I did it with an axe. Not a vestige remained.